It all starts with knowing whether you're going or not, and with whom. It helps if the boy is early with the invitation. That way, the girl feels she's his first choice. And naturally, it's only fair that the girl accept or reject as soon as possible. In most places, it's customary for the boy to give the invitation in person or by telephone. Hello?
Hi, Mary. This is Dick.
Oh, hi, Dick. How are you?
Fine.
Hey, I hear you were great in the game last Saturday.
Well, it sure was a close one.
Yeah, but we pulled through all right. Hey, maybe now we'll go on and win the championship.
Well, I sure hope so.
Say, Mary, as you know, the prom's the 24th.
I think it's going to be a lot of fun. Would you like to go with me?
Dick, it sounds great. I'd love to.
And Jack said his folks are fixing a midnight supper for our crowd after the dance.
That'll be fun.
So we'll be late getting home. Will that be all right?
Oh, I'm sure it will be. But why don't you let me check with Mother tonight?
How about if I pick you up at 7:30?
That's fine.
Good. See you then.
Goodbye, Dick, and thanks for calling.
Hi. Dick, your flowers are just beautiful. They're perfect with my dress.
Well, I have to admit, I had a little help.
They are lovely, Dick.
Aren't they?
Dear, you just look beautiful.
Oh, thank you.
Say, if you two don't want to be late, you better be on your way.
All right.
Good night, Mom.
Good night,
Dad.
Good night, sweetheart.
Night.
Dick, have a nice time.
Oh, okay. We will. See you later.
Good night, Dick.
Night.
And have fun.
So with ease, the big evening begins.
The big evening begins.
Great hair, great dresses, and great expectations. The prom has long functioned as a rite of passage for American teenagers as they act out fantasies of a generally unattainable adult ideal. Why might American families fork over so much for just one night? Well, today we'll discuss where we got this funny little word from, how a high school party evolved into a teenage gateway to adult life. And why filmmakers love to make prom movies that critique American culture. So first, a little background on the word. The word prom is short for promenade, a French word used to describe a leisurely walk or the spaces in which this walk might take place. The word promenade also describes various dance positions. By the late 19th century, prom started to be used to describe a formal dance at a school. A 2014 article in Slate charts the frequency of prom-related words in English texts. In the first half of the 20th century, prom was most used to designate a cotillion-style ball. In the 1980s, usage increased, but shifted from designating a simple school dance to describing a big school blowout. Blowouts, not just for hair. But how did prom become such a critical rite of passage into American adulthood? Let's start by clarifying the phrase rites of passage. The ethnographer Arnold Van Gennep coined this in 1909 to describe a ceremony marking an individual's transition from one social or religious status to another. Van Gennep maintained that a rite of passage has three stages. The first involves preliminal events. Separation from family, breaking with routine, leaving behind something. The second involves liminal activities, a choreographed transition during which an element of one's identity is destroyed to make room for something new. The third involves post-liminal proceedings. The changed individual is reincorporated into society. But given that proms occur closer to this legal coming of age, for some, this party functions as a secular rite of passage. And American filmmakers have long been drawn to this fantasy of social mobility. Cinematic representations of prom can provide great insight into broader social attitudes within American culture. And many filmmakers reproduce Van Gennep's three rites of passage stages in a film formula that I'm sure you'll recognize. Stage one. A teenager enacts the death of their childhood self. They distance themselves emotionally from their family. Stage one, A teenager enacts the death of their childhood self. They distance themselves emotionally from their family. Stage one, a teenager enacts the death of their childhood self. They distance themselves emotionally from their family. They engage in a performance of adult roles, makeup, hair, prom king, queen, or tricked out outfits. They give and wear flowers. They leave their childhood home in a fantasy vehicle, which maybe has a hot tub on the back. Stage two, in the liminal space of prom, the teenager is tested. They may get involved in a fight, or better yet, a dance-off. They navigate peer pressure, they decide whether to try various mind or mood-altering substances. They deflect or initiate sexual advances. In short, they scrutinize adult culture and determine who they hope to be within it. And stage three, the new adult is incorporated into society. If prom takes place in the film's penultimate scene, this might involve busting out some adult dance moves or engaging in a very adult kiss.
By now, if you have been watching all the documentaries that we have released, you would already know. Once again, you see how the dragon is laughing as these Luciferians tell the masses right to their faces what they're doing. By the power of Hollywood, the magic wand of Satan, using lesser magic and mind control to impregnate the will of the dragon into the hearts of this young generation. You heard it directly from the Luciferian's mouth, how Hollywood uses a three-step process to invade the minds and hearts of children and teenagers, to separate themselves from their parents and want to do their own will, falling into the snare of temptation of the world. Do you remember in the second half of the occult roots behind sports when we exposed how Allen Iverson was saying how he wanted to be like Mike? But then we showed you how there was predictive programming and lesser magic done while he was a child, because a very famous and popular commercial was released about Michael Jordan where the world chanted, "I want to be like Mike." This is how powerful these spells are shaping and molding the minds of the masses. So when you see them break down how Hollywood loves to use scenes in movies, shows, and cartoons referencing prom night, and how it is broken down into three parts to assault the minds of the youth while they blindly watch these shows, cartoons, and movies as entertainment, not realizing they're being detained for entry, because that's what it's all about, separating the children from the teachings of their parents and luring them off into the darkness to want to do their own will and rush into adulthood faster than they're supposed to. But this is exactly the teachings of Aleister Crowley, to do what you want, to do your will, do what thou will shall be the whole of the law. Do drugs and fornicate. This is the demonic teachings of the occult. So while they place this into the psyche of billions of people, especially the youth, think of how those seeds will grow and germinate and activate, and parents have no clue why all of a sudden their sons and daughters no longer want to listen to them, want to distance themselves from them and go after the rotten fruit hanging on the branches of the demonic tree, mystery, Babylon. But while we're on the topic of Hollywood, the magic wand of Satan, You heard it from the mouth of the Luciferians themselves, how Hollywood loves pushing the agenda of prom night and doing your own will within the industry. So let us go ahead using the light of Christ to expose this agenda hidden within the darkness in plain sight. We will scratch the surface and microscopically examine just a handful of shows and cartoons and movies so you can start to see the pattern as we break down and expose one of the many ways the dragon is destroying the youth.
Lucifer, I'm here. Wanted to see me?
Yes, I wanted to check on you.
Lucifer, I'm here. Wanted to see me?
Yes, I wanted to check on you.
You know, it made me realize something. All of that high school drama that I missed out on, the girly gossip, the hallway crushes, all those school dances, that's just not who I am. I like being the responsible adult.
Right. So you no longer desire any of that high school poppycock?
No.
Well then, I guess you won't be wanting this. Detective, will you go to the prom with me?
Will you go to the prom with me?
If you did this.
Looking from a window above, it's like a story of love. Can you hear me? Came back only yesterday, moving farther away. Won't you near me? All I needed was
thank you,
dorks going.
Prom, baby!
What?
The prom.
hello, sir. I'm here to pick Raven up. I'm her date.
Raven!
Be right there!
I don't know what's going on, but I am not going to let my daughter go out with someone like you.
Oh, don't worry, sir. I'm a good boy. I'll have her home by 7 p.m., and I'll make sure she doesn't get into any trouble.
That's the problem. Raven is half demon. She must stay out past midnight, revel in mischief, and possibly enslave another dimension.
I was thinking about maybe stopping for ice cream afterwards.
You disgust me.
I'm ready.
Lady! You look stunning.
Raven, your friends can't come. They're going to ruin your big night.
Sorry, Dad, but this is my squad.
Your squad? This is not a Taylor Swift video. This is Demon Prom! This is Demon Prom!
If I'm gonna go, I want to be with my friends.
Very well.
Now, at first, I wasn't even gonna break this one down, as it is very self-explanatory. But then as I thought about it, I wanted to speak to you because once again, they are mocking right to your face using lesser magic. They are showing you exactly what goes on during prom night. Could you imagine all the demonic entities that are in the midst of this satanic gathering? This is exactly what the dragon is saying operating through predictive programming and lesser magic, showing you what really goes on in the spiritual realm, but hiding it under the guise of comedy and cartoons and movies, knowing that most people won't put the spiritual pieces together.
Jinkies, there's no parking. A driver, try around back.
Hey, Daff. What's with your face? You okay? You look like you're gonna hork.
This is exactly like my dream. Us, dancing. Then after, we take a walk in the moonlight, and you whisper in my ear.
Scooby!
Yeah. What? No!
Ghost girl?
I hope you saved a dance for me, Fred!
Let's get out of here!
Like, wow! I didn't know this year's prom theme was terror and pandemonium.
What's going on?
Somebody's mom is trying to kill Fred.
There's a special night in the lives of all of us. A night to be beautiful, to be desirable. A night we can break all the rules and make our own. Prom night. Everyone at Hamilton High is getting ready for prom night. It's a day of rehearsals, arrangements, final preparations, and last-minute phone calls. Too old for games, but someone still wants to play.
Why? Callie, it's been a long time. Tonight, it's my turn.
Everything is on. Tonight, someone has come to the prom alone. Someone who watches in the silent corridors.
Kelly.
Help!
Someone who waits until no one can help. Prom night. If you're not back by midnight, you won't be coming home.
Now, before you and I go any further, I want you to ask yourself the question, what exactly is the Luciferians trying to tell you using the magic wand of Hollywood by the power of lesser magic? It is very clear how many cartoons, shows, and movies have demonic roots when it comes to the prom. And you see, brothers and sisters, Hollywood went on to make 5 more prom horror films. You see, they're continually feeding the minds of the masses this connection hidden in plain sight. But sadly, millions are blinded by the God of this world, and they don't understand that by the means of entertainment is the way the dragon lets it be known what his plans and agendas really are. So let us continue to expose this diabolical plan to completely destroy the minds of the youth.
Hey, what are you doing out here? Don't you want to dance?
Sure.
I'm just a prom night dumpster baby. I got no mom or dad.
You see how easy it is for these Luciferians to turn a tragedy into a comedy, because this is an achievement to them. They know that the mind control and lesser magic that they are putting into the minds, into the psyche of the youth, are transforming them into the character of Lucifer. They have become narcissists, where they only care about themselves and are willing to give birth and throw a baby into a dumpster just so they can make it to the prom.
Inside, they find the tiny body of Melissa's newborn. Inside the banquet hall, Melissa enjoys a salad, reportedly carrying on as if nothing has happened.
Man, babe, you were really out of there for a minute. I think someone probably spiked the punch.
Oh, someone definitely spiked the punch.
Hey, you wanna go dance? Come on. Come
on. Yeah.
After the baby was disposed of, the young woman went out to dance.
After the baby was disposed of, the young woman went out to dance.
What is a blood ritual? A blood ritual often involves a symbolic death and rebirth. As a literal bodily birth involves bleeding, blood is typically seen as very powerful and sometimes as unclean. Blood sacrifice is sometimes considered by the practitioners of prayer, ritual magic, in spellcasting to intensify the power of such activities. Did you hear that, brothers and sisters? It says blood rituals often involve a symbolic death in rebirth. And you can see this all across the industry. Just in the music industry alone, you see this ritual over and over again. But what is the Luciferians trying to impregnate into the minds of those that watch these movies, such as this demonic movie, Carrie, that was written by Stephen King, or others just like it? What exactly is the dragon saying through lesser magic? It is very clear. They are talking about a death and rebirth, just like what was revealed earlier in this documentary. Remember the three stages that Hollywood implements into the minds of the youth through shows, cartoons, and movies that was exposed earlier in this video. It is a rite or ritual to seek after the teachings of Aleister Crowley by turning their back on their fathers and mothers, going off to do their own will in sin, forcing themselves to enter into adulthood while being robbed of their innocence of childhood. So it is a death and rebirth ritual that is done at these demonic prom ceremonies. Make no mistake about it, brothers and sisters. Many of you know, but some don't realize how many young brothers and sisters lose their virginity during this satanic prom night event because of peer pressure and wanting to fit in as they get involved with the whole ceremony. Just look at the breakdown. They start to praise the enemy by listening and dancing to the music of the world, which only promotes the will of the dragon, whether it's doing drugs, fornicating, speaking blasphemous, and the list goes on, lifting their hands and praising Satan, knowing and unknowing. And as the night carries on, the music will shift as there is a atmosphere of lust, what they confuse to be romance, and they dance, gazing each other in the eyes and kissing, which ultimately will lead to fornication at the end of the night for many of them. And these demonic entities go in and out of bodies as the blinded young brothers and sisters continue to participate in this demonic ritual that many blindly call prom night. And you see this blood ritual all through the industry over and over again. But now you know what these people are saying, that they have gone through a death and rebirth where they have died to the will of God, died to the morals of what their parents have taught them, and they have been reborn into the teachings of Aleister Crowley to do what thou will, to do what they want to do, to enter into a world of sin and lawlessness, not even realizing that if they don't turn away while they have a chance, they will be cast into the lake of fire.
Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revelers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God.
Prom season will be here before we know it, and that means it is time to start dress shopping.
So fun! Daisy Malik Shahid, the owner and founder of La Joie, How do you say it? La Joie?
La Jolie MLN.
La Jolie. La Jolie.
The beautiful.
Yes. And we're talking 2024 prom season, right?
Yes, we are. So it's a very exciting time. At La Jolie, we help young ladies find the perfect dress that it caters to their personality, to their style, to express their feminine power. Mm-hmm. Style to express their feminine power.
Mm-hmm. Style to express their feminine power. Mm-hmm.
Their feminine power. Their feminine power. Their feminine power. Their feminine power.
This is for those who have eyes to see and ears to hear. Do you remember earlier when it was exposed how Hollywood uses a three-step process to indoctrinate the minds of the youth, to turn away from the teachings of the parents and ultimately the commands of the Most High, to distance themselves away and wander off into the darkness of sin, transforming their minds to want to do their own will? And remember, this is the teachings of Aleister Crowley. I want you to pay attention to the wording on the screen when referring to this dark feminine energy or power. It says, say goodbye to peer pressure and unrealistic standards. It is clear that what this is saying to the reader is that you don't have to listen to your father and mother. You can turn your back on the teachings of Christ. And they belittle the commands of the Most High God by labeling it unrealistic standards, as if living holy and serving the Most High is simply unrealistic. Then it goes on to entice the young readers to unleash their inner power. Now listen carefully. It says to learn to set your own rules. Did you hear that? Is that not the teachings of Aleister Crowley? To do what thou will. Do what you want to do. You don't have to follow the rules of the Most High God and honor your father and mother. You can do your own thing and set your own rules. Do you see it? It goes on to say that you can ignite your self-confidence and seduce with your magnetism, teaching the art of seduction using the body. Do you understand? And emanating energy in the process. So when you hear this woman promote her line of clothing, of prom dresses, referencing feminine power, it is very clear she's not talking about intelligence, creativity, and things like this. She is referring to the art of seduction. And it is very clear when you start to see the style of dresses that is being propagated in this fashion is impregnating the minds of the young women who want to follow the latest trends, to go out and get this type of dress, putting it on, learning the art of seduction, how to show certain parts of the body that the Most High God clearly has commanded that women should dress a certain way. I want you to watch this video and we'll be right back.
Look at the purple. Stacy
attends York High School. Off the shoulder, this romantic feel is very, very in the season. It just exudes elegance and the glamour and the high slits again. It's very popular.
Very Hollywood.
Yes. Yeah. So it's beautiful. The color, we love the lavender. Lavender is really in right now.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Yes.
So thank you, sweetie.
Stacy looks great.
Stacy looks great.
Mm-hmm. Notice that she keeps emphasizing on this seductive dress. Prom dress, that it is the in thing. It is the one that is in style and very popular. This is a psychological trick to cause the young women watching to want that particular dress because clearly everybody's gonna be wearing it. But when you start to see how the back is revealed, how the chest is exposed, and there is a slit that goes all the way up showing the leg, this is the art of seduction. You understand this divine feminine power that is forbidden, by the way. And this goes all the way back to the book of Genesis and the Garden of Eden, but we're not gonna get into that today. But just remember that Samson was destroyed by Delilah, who operated under the art of seduction with her divine feminine power. So you start to see this loss of innocence. And this is why it was very important to release this documentary, because it is something that has gone under the radar. And it is a literal demonic ritual that forces these young men and women to enter into a demonic realm of seduction, fornication, and the transferring of demonic spirits.
It's gotten so bad, my new alarm clock's the Amber Alert. I'm crying out on the block, but they don't hear the preacher. They're too busy with their idols and their pair of sneakers. You think it's a game until there's nuclear war and bombs drop and America starts looking like Hiroshima.
Now they dying. They dying. So many dying. I thought I told you that the world is a stage. They lying.
You ain't promised tomorrow.
They lying.
You better give your life to Christ.
So many lying.
Before it's too late.
I thought I told you that the world is a stage.
Wake up.
They lying. They lying. So many lying. I thought I told you that the world is a stage. They lying.
Now, before you and I go any further down this road, exposing this demonic occult ritual, I need you to understand a few things. We have made a commitment that in this ministry, we are called to do two things. Number one, and more importantly, is reveal the glorious light of Christ, teaching mysteries and revelations of the Almighty God and His kingdom. This, if you scroll through hundreds of videos, you will see that this is the majority of the videos that we do, and it's what we love to do the most. However, the second thing that we're called to do is expose the darkness. This means that we have to come against as many branches on the demonic tree of occult mystery Babylon as possible. Now, of course, there are other documentaries that are far more important in this last hour, such as The World is a Stage series. I hope you've at least seen part 3 and 4, because by God's grace, part 5 will be coming out sooner than you think. But the reality is, we need to expose as many of the agendas that the dragon is operating through using the magic wand of Hollywood and the industry. These Luciferians are dedicated to serving the dragon and fighting against the principles and the teachings of the Most High God, using witchcraft and magic through the occult to try and cast as many spells and curses on the masses as possible, to keep their eyes blinded so they don't turn to the light of truth, but rather remain stumbling in the darkness of deception. So whether we're doing a major documentary or a smaller video like exposing the occult roots of prom night, somebody has to do it. It is still very important because millions of children, young teenagers, are being forced and cattled into this demonic way of thinking, falling into the teachings of Aleister Crowley, ultimately turning their back on the Most High God. Because remember, anybody could say they love Christ, but the Heavenly Father is going to observe our actions. The Bible makes it very, the Word of God makes it very clear. You can't just love with your words, but in your actions. Now, there may be some that say, why do you have to continue to expose the devil? Why can't you talk about Jesus Christ? First off, the very same hypocrites that say things like this won't even take the time to watch over 300 messages where, by the grace of God the Father, we are diving into revelations and mysteries about Jesus Christ in the kingdom of heaven. Secondly, don't you find it strange how those who claim to follow Christ and hate the dragon would complain that there's actually a ministry online bold enough to stand against as many branches on the demonic tree of Mystery Babylon as possible? Don't you find that kind of strange? How could somebody that claims to love Christ and hate the devil turn around and complain when we're actually exposing the many ways Satan is deceiving the masses? It makes me question their motives and genuinity. Do they truly love Christ, or do they secretly serve the enemy? So by God's grace, we will continue to release messages diving into the mysteries and the revelations of Jesus Christ. There's so many things that we need to know about when it comes to the Most High God and His kingdom. But brothers and sisters, make no mistake about it, we are commanded to expose the dragon, to be a watchman on the wall and warn the people. Because most don't want to do it, because they don't want to throw a rock at a hornet's nest, and they most certainly don't want to ruffle the feathers of lukewarm, hypocritical Christians that will unsubscribe or stop supporting them. They would rather compromise because they're not genuine shepherds that are looking after your soul. I wanted to give this disclaimer before we go to the next chapter of this small documentary, so you can have an understanding of why we do what we do, because we are commanded to. But please understand, you need to take the time and scroll through all the hundreds of videos that the Most High God has been so gracious to give us to give to you. There are so many messages about Jesus Christ and learning more about him that are neglected, that are far more important than exposing prom night. But it doesn't mean exposing prom night is not important, brothers and sisters. I just want you to take the time prayerfully to go look through the other messages, dinner table messages, crying in the wilderness messages, and of course, major documentaries revealing truth that is not talked about and exposing the agenda of the dragon that most that claim to be messengers and teachers are not going to tell you. So with that being said, let us continue down this road of exposing the occult roots behind prom night.
Be not deceived. Evil communications corrupt good manners.
Evil communications corrupt good manners.
I was 17 and I'd only been to second base, but I felt like tonight could be my lucky night.
Hey, kid.
I was 17 and I'd only been to second base, but I felt like tonight could be my lucky night.
Notice the demonic force that Hollywood pushes when it comes to associating prom night with lust, fornication, losing one's virginity, and destroying their innocence.
I know it's like kind of corny or whatever, but it just seems like prom night. It's kind of perfect, you know? We're gonna have like dim lighting and rose petals.
I know it's like kind of corny or whatever, but it just seems like prom night. It's kind of perfect, you know? We're gonna have like dim lighting and rose petals.
Just imagine how many demonic doorways have opened up in the lives of so many young brothers and sisters that have been brainwashed by Hollywood to associate the high school prom with fornication and turning their back on the spirit of innocence. I mean, we're just scratching the surface on all the shows, cartoons, movies, and songs that have been pushing this satanic agenda for years. And the reason why this video is so important for you to share with others is because it goes completely under the radar. Fathers and mothers have been brainwashed to take this lightly, not realizing that there is a demonic entity waiting to devour the innocence of their teenage sons and daughters. And sadly, there are so many so-called Christian parents that are so blinded to this satanic agenda that they don't even realize what is going on right before their very eyes, within the very walls of their own house. Because when a lot of these children are raised up in the spirit of religion instead of the true teachings of the Messiah, learning the love of Christ and the fear of the Most High God, they learn the art of hypocrisy, acting and pretending. But as soon as they leave their house, they're wandering off into the teachings of Aleister Crowley, where they will have a completely different character, where they will dress the part and speak like a believer within their house. But when they wander outside in the midst of the world, they become a completely different person. The following short video that you're about to watch describes what I'm saying to the T. Make no mistake about it. This is exactly what is happening. And the reason why so many so-called Christian parents can't even discern that their sons and daughters are playing the role of a hypocrite, acting in pretending to be religious right before their very eyes is because they're just as much of an actor and pretender as their children are. And when they foolishly send their children to these demonic prom rituals, thinking that their sons and daughters are gonna follow the rules and have a good old innocent time. But secretly, their child has been talking with that old serpent, just like the Garden of Eden. I want you to watch this video and we'll be right back.
Hurry up!
Okay, no, pull over. I have to change. Hurry up. I'm so late. Okay, bye.
And this is exactly why the Word of God says the children will be made twice the child of hell. Remember, to know your enemy's future, look to the past. From the very beginning of time, it was the dragon's agenda to lure the children of the Most High God away from the presence of Christ, to turn their back on the commands of God the Father and take heed to the voice of that old serpent. These Luciferians are operating with power and technology that is literally capable of transforming the minds of the masses. And make no mistake about it, they have declared war against the Son of God. The following clip that you are about to watch from one of the many movies that Hollywood has pushed promoting this demonic agenda is something that is very different, because what they do in this scene is very subtle, but it is actually a declaration of what goes on when these blinded parents send their children to this demonic ritual called prom night. I want you to watch it, and I want to see if you can see what I see.
Let's get ready for prom.
Did you see it? Did you see it? Let me play it one more time.
Let's get ready for prom.
Remember that in the Word of God, the Holy Spirit is described like a dove. What these Luciferians are saying is, as sons and daughters of the Most High God are deceived and lured by the dragon to participate in these satanic events, their innocence, the presence of the Most High God, starts to depart from them as they enter into worldliness, abominations, fornication, drugs, listening to worldly music, and the list goes on. This is exactly what Hollywood was saying in the scene of this movie.
Chapter 3. This know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. From such, turn away. For of this sort are they which creep into houses and lead captive silly women laden with sins, led away with divers lusts, ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Now, as Jannes and Jambres withstood Moses, so do these also resist the truth. Men of corrupt minds, reprobate concerning the faith.
Reprobate concerning the faith.
Of the senior prom. The Bates High School gym is alive with excitement. Everybody is there, even Carrie White, the girl no one likes.
We're all sorry about this incident, Cassie.
It's Carrie!
And everyone makes fun of her.
Pray, Carrie!
The girl who lives in that creepy house with her crazy mother.
Help the sinning woman see the sin of her days and ways. Show her that if she had remained sinless, the curse of blood would never have come on her.
The girl with the strange power.
If I concentrate hard enough, I can move things.
But tonight, no one will laugh at Carrie.
If you don't have a date for the prom next Friday, would you like to go with me?
She's with the best-looking boy in the senior class.
He's trying to trick me again.
She'll be voted queen of the prom.
You know, I can make sure that you don't hurt Carrie White anymore.
For Carrie, it will be a dream come true. For everyone else, it will be a nightmare. Carrie. A new film by Brian De Palma. Based on the chilling bestseller. Starring Sissy Spacek, Piper Laurie, and introducing John Travolta in his first motion picture role. If you have a taste for terror, you have a date with Carrie. Of the senior prom, the Bates High School gym is alive with excitement. Everybody is there, even Carrie White, the girl no one likes.
We're all sorry about this incident, Cassie.
It's Carrie!
And everyone makes fun of her.
Pray, Carrie!
The girl who lives in that creepy house. With her crazy mother.
Help the sinning woman see the sin of her days and ways. Show her that if she had remained sinless, the curse of blood would never have come on her.
With her crazy mother.
Help the sinning woman see the sin of her days and ways. Show her. If she had remained sinless, the curse of blood would never have come on her.
What you just witnessed is one of the most powerful ways Hollywood is using lesser magic through the tell-eye vision to shape and mold the minds of the masses to become the enemies of the cross. It's very subtle and crafty what they do, and this is just one example of many times they have done this through cartoons, shows, movies, and the list goes on. With the light of Christ, we will expose this dark agenda and break it down piece by piece. Notice that Carrie lives in a house that everybody finds to be strange and creepy, and the mother is considered crazy. But what is the character Hollywood makes into Carrie's mother, a religious Christian. Notice that she drags her into the closet. This is a direct assault against Matthew chapter 6, verse 6, where we are commanded to enter into the closet, shut the door, and pray to God the Father in secret. But the subtle and very crafty agenda is to associate crazy with Christianity. Do you see it now? That any parents that would try to keep their children from going into the world and sin are going to be labeled crazy in the psyche of anyone that has blindly watched many of these cartoons, shows, and movies that portray this same exact lesser magic spell by manifesting, by shaping and molding the psyche of the people to become enemies of the cross. Do you understand? You see, by making Carrie's mother into a crazy woman, this is the image that is seared into the conscience of millions of people. Now, some of you might be saying, well, that was the first Carrie. What about the remake? Surely they haven't done it again. I want you to watch this trailer, and we'll be right back to break down and expose the lesser magic of the dragon.
Rightly beams our Father's mercy from his lighthouse evermore. But to us he gives the keeping of the lights of
the... Pick you up after school.
The other kids, they think I'm weird.
Carrie, favorite poem? Did you bring one?
I don't want to be. I want to be normal.
Wipe that smile off your face.
I have to try and be a whole person before it's too late.
Help this little girl see the sin of her days and ways. If she'd made innocent, the curse of blood would
have been... Mom, that's not even in the Bible. It doesn't say that anywhere.
Go to your closet and pray.
No.
Go to your closet and pray.
No. Pray. No!
You pray, little girl. You no! pray for forgiveness.
This is exactly why we continue to tell you that the whole world is a stage. Because when your eyes finally open, and for many of you, they already have, you start to see how much effort these Luciferians put into this Antichrist agenda. Because most people don't understand psychology, subliminal messages, and lesser magic. They don't know about predictive programming and all of these things. They just watch movies for entertainment. But for those who have eyes to see and ears to hear, can see this agenda miles away. And once again, you see the same exact diabolical plan in the remake of this movie, Carrie. The mother is a psychotic Christian. Notice that Hollywood wants people to think going into the closet or having children pray in the closet is an evil thing and something that only a crazy parent would do. The reason why they're doing this is because they are terrified of people finding out the truth of how when you get alone with the Most High God, when you call out to the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, Yeshua the Almighty, when you train up your children in the ways of the Lord, number one, they will not depart. Number two, these satanic, disgusting, perverted Luciferians don't want to be exposed by the light of Christ. So they try to keep the whole world in darkness, blinded to who they really are. But once again, you have seen it with your own eyes and heard it with your own ears. This is how lesser magic is operated through all of these cartoons and shows and movies, and the list goes on. To impregnate the mind, to shape and mold the psyche, to be an enemy of the cross, to hate the prayer closet, to associate crazy with Christianity. I truly believe this was one of the main agendas with Kanye West. And there's others just like him. You see Ryan Garcia and these others that come out portraying the role of Christianity, all while doing crazy things, having multiple personalities in the process. It is very diabolical. But it is also very crafty, subtle, and effective to those who are blinded by the God of this world. But what if I told you there's more? Many of you that are older remember other movies like Grease. My mother loved that movie. But what did it really promote? Was there not a prom? Was there not a promotion of fornication and lust and drugs and worldliness, inducing a fantasy into the minds of those that watched it to want to be like the characters within the movie? But have you ever heard of a movie called Footloose? I want you to watch this trailer and we'll be right back.
He's the new kid in town, and the music's on his side.
Let's dance!
Footloose. Paramount Pictures presents Footloose.
Now, for some of you that are young, you may not understand, but this movie right here took the 80s by storm, captivating the minds of millions of people. But remember what we talked about earlier in this documentary. We are called to do two things. Number one is to reveal the glorious light of Jesus Christ. And the second thing is to expose as many agendas and demonic branches on the occult tree of Mystery Babylon. And once again, just like the movie Carrie, we're going to microscopically break this down and expose the Luciferian agenda within the Hollywood industry. A brief summary of this movie. This young man moved to this town where the rule of law and church was very important and prominent to these people. And all he wanted to do was to dance to music. And of course, there is a prom integrated into this movie. And you see that the agenda is to shape and mold those that are watching the movie to once again slowly transform into the enemies of the cross by looking at Christianity as the ones that always spoil the party, the strict pastors who don't want the youth and the sons and daughters entering into the world of rock music and all of these things, becoming friends with the world, because the scripture says when somebody does that, they become an enemy of the Almighty God, which is the most terrifying thing you could ever imagine, by the way. But I want you to watch this next scene and watch the subtlety and the craftiness of how this young Prince Charming, that's a whole nother topic, by the way, utilizes the scriptures to move and captivate those watching the movie to stand in agreement with him. And we'll be right back.
I'd just like to say something.
It is outrageous.
If you think that
Eleanor, sit down. I think Mr. McCormick has a right to be heard.
Well, I just wanted to say a few words about this motion so that you wouldn't think that we were encouraging destruction with this idea. From the oldest of times, people danced for a number of reasons. They danced in prayer, or so that their crops would be plentiful, or so their hunt would be good. And they danced to stay physically fit and show their community spirit. And they danced to celebrate. And that is the dancing that we're talking about.
Yeah.
Aren't we told? In Psalm 149, praise ye the Lord. Sing unto the Lord a new song. Let them praise his name in the dance.
Amen.
And it was King David. King David, who we read about in Samuel. And what did David do? David danced before the Lord with all his might, leaping and dancing before the Lord, leaping and dancing. And Ecclesiastes assures us that there is a time to every purpose under heaven. A time to laugh, and a time to weep. A time to mourn, and there is a time to dance. And there was a time for this law, but not anymore. See, this is our time to dance. It is our way of celebrating life. It's the way it was in the beginning. It's the way it's always been. It's the way it should be now.
Did you see how moving that scene was? Almost convincing to those who do not walk in the spirit. And of course, in the movie, the daughter confesses to losing her virginity, mocking in the very house of God, in a false form of repentance, showing that the father, who is a pastor, did not have the authority and the eyes to see that he thought he had. But slowly, this pastor starts to be worn down by the charm and the effect of the law of erosion working through this teenager to promote and integrate dancing to worldly music for the prom. Did you hear what I said? He was using the scriptures about dancing and music, but what Hollywood wasn't telling you is that all of these young sons and daughters would dance and sing along to the music of the dragon. Do you understand? You cannot compare the two. What does light have to do with darkness? This is what the word of God says. How could two walk together lest they be agreed? So once again, you see this agenda, this subtle serpentine strategy to cause those that watch the movie to see Christianity as the enemy who always spoils the party. Boring, can never have fun. And we don't need to listen to them. We don't need to obey and honor our father and mother. And we most certainly don't have to listen. And we most certainly don't have to listen to the local pastor and shepherd of the community. Just like we learned earlier in the documentary, there are three stages that Hollywood operates when using lesser magic to bewitch the children and the teenagers. Number one, to separate themselves from their father and mother and the commands of the Most High God. And then to enter into the darkness of sin, the wilderness of sin, and do what they want, to do what thou will, the teachings of Aleister Crowley, you see. And then ultimately, to choose that sin and lose that innocence and become an open vessel for demonic entities to enter in and take over the house. But brothers and sisters, make no mistake about it. The theme song for this movie is what really made it. Because back then it was very catchy. Many people were singing along to this soundtrack. But I want to show you the words on the screen. And once again, I want to see if you see what I see. Did you hear that? I want you to hear the words one more time. He said, "Kick off my Sunday shoes." This is referencing pushing church to the side. Do you see it? But then he goes on to say, "Please, Louise, pull me off of my knees." He's saying, "I ain't got time to be praying. It's time to go and do what I want to do, to dance and to forget about Christ and praying, to put off my Sunday shoes and put on my worldly dance shoes, that I can go into the midst of the congregation of the wicked." Brothers and sisters, I want you to think about the thousands upon thousands of cartoons, TV shows, movies, songs that have this same exact agenda. And you tell me this is not one of the most powerful weapons that the dragon has been using in the end of the days to impregnate and plant a seed into the psyche of billions of people to become the enemies of the cross. And of course, this very movie was even mentioned in The Simpsons.
And finally, effective immediately, I'm overturning this school's ban on dancing.
And did you know not too long ago, the very high school that this demonic movie was filmed at called back this Prince Charming actor to visit them during the prom one last time?
Hard to believe, but it's the 40th anniversary of Footloose, and the high school where the movie was shot is getting ready for prom. So what would be cooler than to invite the star of the movie? But would Kevin Bacon show up? Here's Jim Murray.
It's been 40 years since Kevin Bacon danced at the prom in the movie Footloose. The smash 1980s film about a teenager bringing dancing to a small town where dancing has been outlawed was filmed at Payson High School in Utah. Now, the students have been trying to get Kevin Bacon's attention. They want him to come back to their prom before the school is demolished at the end of the year.
The whole world is a stage. What I am about to reveal to you is something that the dragon does not want you to know. What if I told you that there is a spirit of confusion that enters into the young, teenage brothers and sisters that blindly participate in this demonic high school prom ritual? I want you to notice that the ceremony is very similar to marriage. Usually, the young man will ask a young lady to the prom. This is like the proposal, the engagement, the same way a man would ask a woman to be his wife, to propose to her. The prom is a mock ceremony of marriage. But I'm going to show you why so much fornication happens during this satanic event. Using the light of Christ, let us expose what is hidden in the darkness. And darkness also means ignorance, because the word of God says, "My people perish for a lack of knowledge." So the dragon understands, he knows how to operate using psychological warfare. And by causing the youth to go through a mock wedding ceremony, he knows it will bring a spirit of confusion. Let me explain. After the boy makes a proposal by asking a young girl to the prom, I need you to follow me here. We're gonna mirror the ritual of the prom to an actual development of a wedding in marriage. So just as he proposes and she says yes to the prom, notice they dress up. The young man would dress up like a groom prepared for a wedding in a nice suit. And the young woman would adorn herself in a very elegant dress, just as a bride would have on during the marriage ceremony. And as they are at this demonic prom, they're dancing. They're seductively and what they believe to be romantically dancing to worldly music that is engaging their minds to think they're actually in love with one another. But if you have studied the scriptures, you will know there are different types of love. And there is the agape love of God. There is the filial love, but there's something called eros love. This is where you get the word erotic. And what happens is the youth doesn't have the ability to distinguish the differences between the different levels of love. So they confuse a genuine love that a husband would have for his wife and vice versa with eros love, erotic, lust-filled love. And as their brain is being conditioned through the night of dancing together, looking each other in the eyes, this is a confusion to the mind that the soul is tricked into thinking they're becoming married. Well, brothers and sisters, last time I checked that after a wedding ceremony, the husband will take his bride and go get alone to become intimate. And you see, back then, there was a time when many young women remained virgins until they were married. And this is why so many fornicate during the prom, and why so many, especially the young sisters, plan to lose their virginity, because their brains are confused. It is a very powerful witchcraft assault against the psyche to bring the spirit of confusion, causing many young men and women, teenagers, to lose their innocence and fornicate by the end of the night. And make no mistake about it, 8 out of 10 relationships, or so-called dating, 8 out of 10 that quote-unquote date and have a what they believe to be relationship don't even last to begin with. And they go on in life with the spirit of confusion, brokenhearted, infested with demons that has been transferred by the multiple people they have fornicated with. It is such a subtle and crafty demonic agenda. But as a servant of the Most High God, I was sent to warn you and to warn and for you to warn as many as possible, as this prom season is already at hand. This very subtle, under the radar, demonic agenda. But remember, the word of God says it is the small foxes that spoil the vine. And sometimes the things people take the lightest can do the most damage, brothers and sisters. But listen, I gotta go. We're gonna pray together, because there are far more important documentaries that have to get done. Dinner table messages and crying in the wilderness videos. Look around you. Look at the handwriting on the wall. Look at the war in the Middle East. Many nations, just as prophesied. The river Euphrates is drying up, just as prophesied. The abomination swept across the earth, just as prophesied. But are you ready for the return of the Messiah? Are you living holy? Are you denying yourself and picking up your cross, following after him? Or are you a friend of the world? Do you dance and praise for the King of Glory by praising him and singing spiritual songs? Or are you participating in the music of Mystery Babylon? Please be on the lookout for other documentaries and videos that will be uploaded sooner than you think by the grace of God. But please understand, we are at war against the algorithm of the beast, and many of you do not get notified. So you have to manually go in and check the YouTube channel at least a couple times a week. Go to our website and you can watch videos that have been banned on YouTube directly on our website. We love you all so much. Let us go ahead and pray. And this prayer is going to be for anybody that has participated in prom or were planning to do so. You must get cleansed from this spirit of confusion, this satanic mock wedding that brought a confusion, inducing a lie as if you were married and went on to the false honeymoon, as the world calls it, fornicating at the end of the night. Let us pray. I want you to say this with me. Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth, Yeshua the Almighty, I repent of all sins. Please wash me in your holy blood, mind, body, soul, and spirit. I renounce and reject all the ways of the world. Every enemy of you, Almighty Father, is an enemy of me. I don't want to be friends with the world. I reject the world as a friend. I ask you to wash me clean and deliver me from any unclean spirits that could have entered into me when I participated in the ways of the world, whether going to the club, a bar, or participating in this demonic prom ritual. Remove the spirit of confusion, this mock wedding that confused my soul to think I was a part of a marriage, falling prey to fornication, scattering my soul to many fornicating partners. Cleanse me from any transferring of spirits that entered in through fornication in these demonic rituals of dancing and singing along to the music of Babylon. Lord Jesus Christ, cause me to desire the things that you want me to seek after, and filter out all the ways of the dragon, all the desires of the world, the teachings of Aleister Crowley, everything that has been put into my mind by Hollywood and all of the ways they have used lesser magic to try to make me an enemy of the cross, to hate prayer, to despise the closet, to not want to read. Lord Jesus Christ, remove the ways of the dragon out of my life and give me a hunger and thirst after you and your kingdom. I declare that through your word, your mighty name, and by the sprinkling of your blood, I am forgiven, I am washed, renewed, and restored. In the almighty name of Jesus Christ, Yeshua, the Son of God, I pray. Amen. Brothers and sisters, we love you all so much. Please, I know this was not a major documentary. And with everything going on in the world, you don't know if you're promised tomorrow. We don't know if the grid will remain by the time you're finishing this video. Anything can happen as God allows it, because number one, judgment must begin in the house of God. And when you see so many so-called Christians living phony, pretending and acting, secretly living a life of sin, all while masquerading as if they love the Son of God. Will you follow? Will you follow the majority to the lake of fire? This is my question. Or will you walk that straight and narrow path that many don't want to go down? You will be persecuted. You will go through hardships to enter into the kingdom of heaven. This is what the word tells us, but it will be worth it. But make no mistake about it. You have no other choice. You choose life. Choose Christ. Hold his hand. And don't let go.